Hi, I'm Pastor Daryl Boomer, and I have the privilege of pastoring New Glarus Bible Church in the beautiful community of New Glarus, Wisconsin. And I want to invite you to worship with us via one of our recorded worship services you'll find right here online. Let me just tell you a little bit about our church. We are a Bible-centered church, and currently we're walking through the book of Matthew. We have a thriving Awana ministry, and we have a growing youth ministry. Our church is growing, and it's really a pretty exciting time to be a part of the New Glarus Bible Church. So we would love to have you come visit us some Sunday morning. Our services start at 10:30, and I promise you will be warmly welcomed at the door.
For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ.
Invite God into our service. Yeah, you could be seated while I pray. Father, we come before you today and we thank you for just your many, many blessings in our lives. We thank you for a beautiful place to meet, a place to worship you and to hear your word. We thank you for our church, our congregation, the relationships that we have, that the opportunity to encourage one another in the faith. Lord, we thank you for the many material blessings that you've given to us. We thank you that we live in a free country and pray, Lord, that it would remain that way. Lord, we invite you into this service today. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
Oh, my soul, worship this holy.
The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. Therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Jim. If you'd turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 11. Today I want to talk to you about where are you in your spiritual journey. We will be looking at much of Matthew chapter 11 today. One of the questions I like to ask people is just, where are you in your spiritual journey? Some people will open right up to you and they will tell you where they are in their spiritual journey. Other people will shy away. I've often had conversations with people who are willing to talk about houses and jobs and kids and sports and just about anything. But when you attempt to turn the corner and turn that conversation into a spiritual conversation, they will weave and bob and dodge and change the subject. I had a situation like that actually fairly recently. They changed the conversation. But this is a good question for us. You know, where are you on your spiritual journey? Are you growing? Are you stagnant? Are there things going on in your life that are hindering you from growth? So today what I want to do, looking at much of Matthew chapter 11, is for us to just ponder that question. Because this question is more important than how the Packers are doing, how the Badgers are doing. The Badgers aren't doing so well. They had a rough day yesterday. It's more important than your 401k and how it's performing. It's more important than your physical health. It's more important than the trajectory of your career. You know, where are you with Christ? One of the things that we might consider, you know, is are we too busy? Are we too preoccupied? Are we too intellectual for any of that religious, spiritual nonsense? Are we indifferent? And so we're going to be seeing much of that today. So as you look at Matthew chapter 11, I want you to look at verse 15, where Jesus is giving this message. He's surrounded by people, and he says this, "He who has ears, let him hear." And Jesus would say that often because he'd be speaking to people and they'd be listening physically. They could hear, but they weren't listening with their hearts or with their minds. And so today as we go into this passage, he who has ears, let him hear. I have six types of people. Where'd Jim go? My fault. I have six kind of type of people, six questions for us to consider today. First question is this: are you following Christ and yet wrestling with doubt? Go to chapter 11. Let's look at verse 2. We were here a couple weeks ago talking about John the Baptist. We'll start in verse 1. After Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went out on from there to teach and preach in the towns of Galilee. We need to understand that. When John heard in prison what Christ was doing, he sent his disciples to ask him, "Are you the one who was to come, or should we expect someone else?" Do you remember John the Baptist's situation? John the Baptist is in prison, and the reason that he's in prison is not for doing something wrong, but rather for doing something right. He confronted King Herod for the fact that King Herod had actually stolen his brother's wife. He divorced his wife, she divorced her husband. They got married, and John the Baptist confronted him, and because of that, he's in prison. And what's going on in his life right now is he's going through a season of doubt. He's the one who forecasted that Jesus would come. And now that Jesus has come, and now that he's in prison, he's going through a season of doubt. Let's be reminded of who John the Baptist was. He was not like a reed swayed by the wind, verse 7. He was a prophet, and he was more than a prophet, it says in verse 9. He was prophesied about in the Old Testament. And he was the greatest person born of a woman, according to Jesus. And when John the Baptist preached, people listened and they responded. But yet, he's going through a season of doubt. Jesus, you said that when you would come, that you would free the prisoners. And the fact of the matter is, I'm in prison and I'm a prisoner. What's going on here, Jesus? And, you know, solid Christians can go through times that shake their faith, much like John the Baptist. You might be going through something today where you're questioning, you know, if God is good, then why am I going through what I'm going through? If God is good, then why have you allowed these things to happen to me? I've had seasons of doubt. I think anybody who's been a Christian for any period of time has had a period of doubt. The greatest prophets had seasons of doubt and depression. Moses, remember, he wanted to die. Elijah had a tremendous season of depression and doubt after he had a great spiritual victory. Job regretted the day that he was born. Jeremiah said this, "Cursed be the day I was born. May the day my mother bore me not be blessed. Why did I ever come out of the womb to see trouble and sorrow and to the end of my days in shame?" So going through a period of doubt or depression is something that every Christian can expect.
Charles Spurgeon was the prince of the preachers, and he often suffered what he called a minister's fainting fits. There's times where you go into severe depression. He wrote this. As it is recorded that David, in the heat of battle, grew weary, so may it be written of all the servants of the Lord. Fits of depression come over the most of us. Usually cheerful as we may be, we must at intervals be cast down. The strong are not always vigorous. The wise are not always ready. The brave are not always courageous. And the joyous are not always happy. So everyone goes through seasons of depression and doubt. Let's look at verses 4 through 6. Jesus answers John the Baptist's question. John sends a couple of his disciples to Jesus to ask him that question, and Jesus replies, "Go back and report to John what you hear and you see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor. Blessed is the man who does not fall away on account of me." So in other words, what Jesus says to John, it's really good that you're asking questions. I want you to keep asking questions, but I want to let you know, I am the one that was written about in the Old Testament. I am the one that you have been preaching about. Don't lose your faith on account of me. And so your spiritual journey might be marked by seasons of doubt. And so, you know, the Bible would tell us, don't worry, rather continue to seek answers to your doubt. And that's what John the Baptist did. Another person that we see in this passage is a person who is perpetually spiritually dissatisfied. Perpetually spiritually dissatisfied. Go down to verses 15 through 19. Jesus says, "He who has ears, let him hear. To what can I compare this generation? They are like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling out to others. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, here is a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. But wisdom is proved right by her actions." You know, hopefully there's nobody here today that would fit in this category, but there are people who are perpetually and spiritually dissatisfied. You just cannot please them. And back in those days, what kids used to do in the marketplaces is they would gather together and they'd say, let's play the game wedding. And so they would point at a child and say, you be the bride, you be the groom, you be the preacher. And they would enact like a wedding. And then at other times they would go, let's play funeral. You be the preacher, you be the congregation, and you be the dead man. But what Jesus is saying is that no matter what they were given, whether playing wedding or funeral, they were constantly and adamantly dissatisfied. Jesus goes on to say, you know, John the Baptist came and he was too stern. He was too hard. He preached too hard. Repent. And they rejected him. And then he said, well, Jesus came. And Jesus was more in the celebratory mode. Jesus was too liberal. They called him a glutton and a drunkard. He started his ministry at a wedding reception. And he turned the water into wine. Some of John the Baptist's disciples came to Jesus one day and they asked him, why do we and the Pharisees fast often, but your disciples do not fast? Jesus said to them, the wedding guests cannot mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them, can they? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. So when Jesus was in his ministry mode, people were discontent because he was in the wedding mode. When John the Baptist was there, they were discontent because he was more like a funeral dirge. And both of them are accused of having a demon. It says here that for John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a demon. And then look over at Matthew chapter 12, verse 24, just to the right. But when the Pharisees heard this, they said, "It is only by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that this fellow, Jesus, drives out demons." So they're demonizing John the Baptist, they're demonizing Jesus, and they're dissatisfied with both of them. Both of them are rejecting Christ and his miracles and his message, and they're basically saying, "We don't want to play. We don't want to play." Let me give you some common application. You know, oftentimes Christians can be dissatisfied. You know, the church is too conservative. The church is too contemporary. The music is too loud and old. The music are too soft and old, or the music is too loud and new. The pastor is too conservative or liberal. And so let me say this. Let us be spiritually discerning and not accept things that aren't biblical, but never let us get to the point where we are perpetually and spiritually dissatisfied with the way God is working through different individuals or different congregations. We don't want to be like this. Well, John the Baptist and Jesus preached a message of repentance. Both of them said, turn away from a self-centered lifestyle. Turn away from sin. Both of them rocked the boat. And the people of his day said, "We don't want to play. We're not satisfied." So here's a question for you, and I hope that you aren't here. Is your spiritual journey marked by a perpetual dissatisfaction? With whatever God is doing around you, it's not good enough, it's not enough. The third person I want to look at is the one who's indifferent to what Christ is doing around them. Let's go to look at verses 20 through 24. When Jesus began to denounce the cities in which most of his miracles had been performed because they did not repent. "Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethesda! If the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be lifted up to the skies? No, you will go down to the depths. If the miracles that had been performed in you had been performed in Sodom, it would have remained to this day. But I tell you that it will be more bearable for Sodom on the day of judgment than for you." Jesus is denouncing the cities that are right around the Sea of Galilee. He's denouncing Chorazin. He's denouncing Bethsaida. He's denouncing Capernaum. Jesus did most of his ministry right around the Sea of Galilee. This was his church. And according to this passage here, he did many miracles there. Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount just about right about there, not far away. Jesus healed people, the blind and the lame. Jesus calmed the Sea of Galilee. Jesus walked on the water, the Sea of Galilee. He did all kinds of miracles here. And he says that the people are indifferent. They didn't care. And so what did Jesus say to him? He said, "Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, the Bethsaida." What does it mean, woe? It means that soon judgment is going to come upon you. Jesus is denouncing Jewish communities, and at the same time, he is saying the worst Gentile communities, Sidon and Tyre. If you look through the Old Testament, you find all kinds of stories from them. They were bad places. They were port cities where sailors would come in, and they would spend their money getting drunk and on prostitutes. They were bad cities. And then he says, Sodom, you all know Sodom, right? Sodom and Gomorrah, which is the worst of the worst. He says that when judgment comes, Sodom and Gomorrah, Sidon and Tyre are going to be judged less harshly than you. Because if they had had the miracles that you had performed in them, they would have repented a long time ago in sackcloth and ashes. You know, we can become indifferent to the things of God. I would think in America we become very indifferent to the things of God. This sanctuary actually should be filled. But there are many, many people that are indifferent to what God is doing. And God pronounces judgment upon them. America was founded on Christian principles. We are swimming in gospel blessings to the point that we take Jesus for granted. Amen? There's a lot of people that, you know, I'm busy doing other things. We are as evil as Sodom and Gomorrah, and we are deserving of punishment. The things that happened in Sodom and Gomorrah that were condemned by God are celebrated in America today. Isn't that right? Ruth Graham Bell said this, "If God doesn't punish America, he is going to have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. Because the way we're living is as bad and perhaps even worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. The things that are approved of in our culture, the things that are celebrated in our culture are worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. And just as there are degrees of reward in heaven, there are degrees of punishment in hell. In other words, the cities where Jesus had performed all of his miracles, he says that your punishment is going to be worse than Sidon, Tyre, and Sodom and Gomorrah. And the difference between heaven and hell isn't based upon our actions, our morality. It's based upon what we do with Jesus. Those who accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, Jesus says, your sins will be forgiven and you will spend eternity in heaven. Those who reject Jesus, the Bible makes it very clear, will spend eternity in hell. In heaven, there are degrees of reward. In hell, there are degrees of punishment. So your indifference to spiritual realities are really a serious matter. And to ignore what God is doing around you brings greater judgment upon you. And so here's a question. Is your spiritual journey marked by indifference to the good things that God is doing around you? Here's another question for us. Are you too intelligent to believe in Jesus? Look at Matthew chapter 11, verse 25. At that time, Jesus said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, and you have revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, this was for your good pleasure." When Jesus says that he had hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent, that is what we called sanctified sarcasm. they really weren't wise and intelligent. He's using sanctified sarcasm. And he's saying to them this. He says, you know what? I have hidden things from you, but I have revealed them to the children. Why did he hide things for those who were wise and intelligent? Because they are too proud to see what even children can see. They're too proud to see even what children can see. They exalt their knowledge and they cling to their degrees. And today, this is what they would say. They would proudly say, I believe in science. I believe in science. I believe in science too. But we all must admit that science is ever-changing, isn't it? I mean, when you look at what was considered science back in the 1900s and then science advanced in the 2000s, it changed, didn't it? And so science is forever changing. Think of our 2 years under COVID, where the science was ever changing. But here's the difference. The Word of God never changes. Isn't that right? The Word of God never changes. I remember vividly a master's level professed Christian student at UW-Madison saying this to me. She said, it drives me crazy when Christians say things that don't line up with science. She said they should do their research before they preach or they teach. That's what she said. And as Christians, we ought to say, it drives us crazy when professing Christians say things that don't line up with the Bible. Listen, science will one day catch up to the Bible. Christians believe in science, but we acknowledge that science changes every day and that God's truth never changes. Sometimes it takes time for science to catch up with the timeless truths of the Bible. He hides things for those who profess to be wise. Look at Romans chapter 1. Paul writes, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since that which may be known about God is plain to them, why is it plain to them? Because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from that which has been made, so that people are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile, and that means their thinking became as nothing, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. They exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to make look like mortal human beings and birds and animals and reptiles. They worshiped the created things and they refused to worship God. And we see this today. I mean, this is where many people are today. It says in this passage that men are without excuse. Why are they without excuse? Because God's invisible qualities are clearly seen when you look at the blue skies and you look at the stars and you look at the trees and you look how everything that God has created it brings glory to him and benefit to man. You know, without excuse. Every designed thing has an intelligent designer. Everything. I have yet to see a house that has been built by random chance over billions of years. There are no houses out there built by random chance over billions of years. I've yet to see a car built by random chance in billions of years. I've yet to see an airplane. I have yet to see a soda bottle that has been designed by random chance in billions of years. And when we look around, the chair that you're sitting on was designed by a mechanical engineer or some sort of engineer. This building was built by engineers, very, very intelligent people. Everything that you see that is designed was designed by an intelligent designer. And more than anything, when you look at your hands, when you look at your body, this is the greatest thing that has ever been designed by God. There's no way that this came about over billions of years in random chance. God says here in this passage that their thinking became futile as they declared themselves to be wise. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, "For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. The intelligent of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise man? Where is the scholar? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world?" God hides spiritual truth from those who refuse to believe spiritual truths. And so my question for us today is, you know, is our spiritual journey marked by a proud intellectualism that keeps us from following Jesus? Are you humble like a child? Are you humble like a child? Look at verses 25 through 27. Jesus says in these verses that that he reveals wisdom to little children. He makes things known. Go in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 19. Jesus loves children. Chapter 19, a little bit to your right. Verse 14, Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." Jesus was constantly, you know, let the little children come to me. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. On Thursdays and Fridays, our building is filled with children. From one end of the building to the other. I'm kind of confined to my little office up in my perch there because there's kids everywhere. On Friday, I came down. I was restless. I came into the gym. I was standing right over there. There were a whole bunch of kids playing, a whole bunch of them over here. And immediately, one of them saw me and knew me and goes, "Pastor Darrell." And he kicks a ball to me. And so I kicked the ball back. And so we did that like three or four times. And then a little girl that I didn't know, she came up to me and she goes, "Hold your hands open like this." And I held my hands open and she threw me a ball. And I threw it back. So I'm kicking and I'm catching. And then another little girl came up and she holds your hands like this, like a basket, you know. And so she's throwing the ball through the hoop. So I'm kicking, I'm catching, I'm holding. Before long, I have all these kids around me. You know what? I loved it. I mean, that's the same attitude. Jesus would have loved it too. Jesus loves the little children. In Matthew chapter 18, turn a little bit to your left, verses 1 through 4. That time the disciples came to Jesus and they asked, you know, "Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And he called a little child and had him stand among them, and he said, "I tell you the truth, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself like this child is greatest in the kingdom of heaven." The question is, are you humble like a little child? Many years ago, we were in our van. I can remember it vividly. We were on Forest Lane. Zach, 5-year-old Zach's in the back seat with 3-year-old Galena. And Zach said in frustration as they were having an argument, he said, "Galena, you have a lot to learn." Proud little Zach. You know, God, He reveals things to those who are humble like children. And I, you know, just thinking of my conversion 40 some years ago, and just thinking about the fact that God continually had to break me down, continually humble me, till I got to the point where I was willing to listen to God. Can you relate to that? Perhaps God did that to you as well. When we humble ourselves, what God begins to do is reveal himself to us. So here's a question for you. Is your spiritual journey marked by a humble dependence upon God? And if it is, then God will reveal spiritual truth to you, and not only that, you will enter the kingdom of God. Are you wearied and burdened by religious rules and regulations? Let's go down here and verse 28, and Jesus said, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Jesus is speaking to a crowd of people, and the crowd of people are primarily Jewish people, Jewish people who had been following the Pharisees and the scribes. And the Pharisees and scribes back in Jesus' days had just added on what is called the traditions of men. In other words, they just kept adding on more rules and more regulations. In the Mishnah, there were over 2,000 additional laws that they were supposed to keep in regard to the Old Testament. So in other words, in the Old Testament, we had 10 commandments, okay? And then throughout the Old Testament, there are 613 positive and negative commandments. 365 of them would be like, do not fear, okay? So we had positive and negative commands. What the scribes and the Pharisees did is they took like the command that we are to honor the Sabbath day and we are to keep it holy. And what they did is they added on layer of rules and regulations so that you would honor the Sabbath day and keep it holy. But in the process, what happened is people lost the original intent. The original intent of the Sabbath was that you would spend time with God and that you would thank him for his mercy and his grace and his blessing. And what had happened in the process is the Sabbath became a big burden. And the people were weary and burdened by all of the laws. And so what Jesus said to those people, "Come unto me, all of you who are weary and burdened by all of these needless regulations." There are people today who are afraid of Christianity because they mistake Christianity for that. If I become a Christian, I have to do all of these things, and there's all of these things I cannot do. Jesus said, "Come unto me." Jesus did not say, "Come unto religion." Jesus did not say, "Come unto all these regulations." Jesus said, "Come unto me and have a personal relationship with me. And then what I will do is I will give you rest." He said, "Take your yoke, my yoke upon you." And there's a picture of a yoke. Some of the things that a yoke does is it ties two together. We could compare that to taking on a yoke today and the fact that when we become Christians, we're all yoked together. You don't have to do all the work. A yoke also ties the oxen to their leader. When we take Jesus' yoke on us, what we do is we allow him to steer us and to guide us. And as he steers us and guides us, you know what he does? He takes the way that he designed you and he leads you into an area where you're going to be the most productive and you're also going to be the most blessed. Okay, I enjoy what I'm doing up here. This is the way God designed me. I would not want to be over here. Okay, I wouldn't want to be back there doing what Jim does. That's not the way he designed me. You can know when you are really, really stressed in your life, perhaps you're not taking on Jesus' yoke, you're taking on a man-made yoke. Another thing that the yoke does is it binds you to the load that you are to carry. And Jesus says that I make you a yoke that will make that load light. So Jesus took all the Old Testament laws, he reduced them down to two laws, which are basically love God and love people. And he says, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is going to enable you to do what I've called you to do. None of us can be holy apart from the Holy Spirit. Before I had the Holy Spirit, I did not care about holiness. Once you become a Christian, you have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's number one job is to make you holy. If you have no desire to be holy, you probably aren't a Christian, okay? Because that's what the Holy Spirit does. Jesus says that if you come to him, he will give you rest. Those of you who are the weary and heavy laden. There's a legend. This is not a true story, but it illustrates the point. And the legend says this, that above Jesus' carpentry shop, there was a sign that said, "We make the world's best yokes." Isn't that awesome? Jesus makes the best yokes. So let me tie this together really, really quick. Jesus says, come unto me, all of you who are believers, but you're wrestling with doubt. Jesus says, come unto me, those of you who are perpetually spiritually dissatisfied. You'll find satisfaction. Jesus says, come unto me, all of you who are indifferent to the miracles and the message of Jesus, all of you who are indifferent to what God is doing all around you. He says, come unto me. Jesus says, come unto me, all of you who are too intellectual, too smart. And he says, you know what I will do? I will give you true wisdom. Jesus says, come unto me, all of you who are humble like little children. And come unto me, all of you who are weary and burdened by religious rules. Jesus wants everyone to come to him. And today, that's what he's doing. He's inviting you today to come to him and accept him as your Lord and your Savior. Let's pray. Father, each and every one of us is at a different point in our spiritual journey. Lord, some may be here today like John the Baptist and they're wrestling with doubts. Lord, I pray that you would give them comfort and that you would continue to empower them to continue to follow you and trust you. Lord, there are some here today that are like little children. They're perpetually dissatisfied. Lord, I pray that they might find rest in you. Lord, there are some here today that are indifferent to what you're doing around them. Pray that you convict them. Lord, that you would draw them to yourself. Pray for those who are proud of their intellectualism. Lord, I pray that you would humble them. I pray for those who are like little children, Lord, that you would bless them. And Lord, I pray for each and every person that is here today that is weary and burdened by religious rules. Lord, I pray that they might find their rest in a relationship with you. And I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. May God's grace and peace be upon you. You're dismissed.